Hello, lovelies, and welcome to another episode. I am so excited and honored today to have another conversation with Dr. Serena, a naturopathic doctor. And today we talk about the brain and mental health. And I love this conversation because we talk about this from the place of the body, all the body organs impact our mental health. It's not just about the brain, but there are different things that might be happening that either impact or mimic mental health conditions. So the conversation is so rich around that. What are the things that might be influencing our well-being and how we feel emotionally and mentally? We address all of the different ways that we could support how we're feeling. We give alternative suggestions on how to address different conditions and different needs so that we're not dependent on psychotropic medicines if we don't want to be, or just on supplements, or feeling like we don't have options and that we might not be able to resolve this thing, or we're stuck with this thing for life. So we actually have a wonderfully resourceful conversation in that there's a lot of different things that we could do to take care of ourselves and to enrich our experience and our journey so that we could feel well and resourced and have a lot of vitality and joy in our life. That's what we're here to do so that we could have the best relationship and best life that we want. Stay tuned. You're in for a treat. Let me read you her bio and then we'll say hello to Serena. Dr. Serena Goldstein is a naturopathic doctor who guides you to trust and understand what your body is telling you. She has a diverse, deep, and growing knowledge base around conventional medicine, natural modalities, energy medicine modalities, and spirituality, where she seeks to find and address the root cause of symptoms with an individualized plan that also feels like relief. Dr. Serena works with those experiencing weight gain, hormonal imbalance, poor sleep, stress, thyroid, mood, and gut health issues who want to learn more about what their body is saying and needs. She has also shared her expertise on outlets such as Mind Body Green, Forbes, and Shape.com. She has appeared on NYU Dr. Radio Cyrus XM, written multiple research articles on mind-body healing, presented at numerous conferences, and has served as an advisory board member for Natural Practitioner magazine. You can find her at drserenagoldstein.com. Hello and welcome, Serena. I'm so happy to have you here again with us today.
Yes, I'm so happy to be here as well. Thank you again.
Let me tell you something. I had so much fun at the last conversation when we talked all hormonal things. And today we're going to talk about more of the brain side of things. I want to say less physical and more mental, more abstract, but I'm not sure if that's true. So as the conversation unfolds, we'll see how it plays out, right? Because the body definitely is a part of all of this. But I'm super psyched for this topic because the brain, the mind, and all of the things that are going to come with this are my cup of tea. Mm-hmm. And so happy to delve into the nuances of how to work with the brain from a different angle that is not psychotherapy, right? So, yay, super
exciting. Definitely, yes.
Very good. So let me ask you the first thing then. So how do you find that mental health and mental health topics or issues that people might be experiencing show up in your practice? Because I don't know if people come to you for necessarily for mental health problems, right? But so you tell me, like, how does it show up for you? Like, is it a side thing? Do people come for it? Like, how does it play out?
So it tends to play out in a variety of ways. So a lot of the times, yes, a lot of people know me for hormones, weight, the whole general endocrine system. However, a lot of the times I'll find, oh, but then I was also put on this psych med when I was a teenager, or, oh, I just went through a really rough time and the doctor put me on fill in the blank with the prescription.
Right.
Maybe they just feel like they haven't been themselves lately, which I will say too, can also be a sign of imbalanced hormones as well, because, you know, as we may get into it, but hormones and neurotransmitters, which are responsible for our mood, like dopamine, like the reward hormone, a lot of those do tend to mirror hormones themselves. So it is interesting sometimes how the symptoms and how they present can actually look similar.
Yes.
Or it may be they just need some more motivation. It can literally just be more of the talk therapy or lifestyle counseling. You could say they've tried everything. They have no idea what to do next. If anyone's ever heard of the fight, flight, freeze, or fawn, they're probably somewhere along the mix of all of those when it comes to trying to figure out what next to do for help. So that's where I tend to see whether it's, again, people wanting to get off psych meds, or maybe they were recommended one and they're like, no, we want to go natural. Mm-hmm. Or it becomes more of a behavioral pattern piece of, I want to stop eating this food, or I want to quit this habit. I want to know my next level of health. And it's just more of how do we work with that personality and how do we work with the person themselves?
Right. So I think I'm hearing that people might come in for a bunch of different things. There's not one way that they might come in, even though you do specialize in, like you said, in weight loss or hormonal endocrine system things. But then you might have these other flavors show up in that, I'm taking all this medicine also, or this other thing is playing out, or however the thing shows up, then you might see, oh, there's something else going on that impacts how you're feeling overall, that might show up as mental health conditions or symptoms, motivation or not feeling so hot, or all the things that just all the systems are interacting with each other, and it shows up as a mental health thing in other areas of their life. So you do see the diagnoses come up as well. Like, what kind of diagnoses have you seen that people mention that they have when they come to see you?
I would say usually anxiety and depression would be the biggest, the predominant ones.
Right.
And interestingly, or maybe, similarly, they do tend to fall along the lines of imbalanced hormones. They're not sleeping properly. They're not eating the right foods. So while they may come in and check off certain boxes, at the same time, I'm also looking past the diagnosis to say, but did something just happen in their life? Or how long have they been dealing with this? Are they on other medications that could be depleting certain vitamins and minerals? Because actually psych meds can do that.
Yes.
That could really be contributing to, again, the person sitting in front of me. So how much of it is the actual diagnosis, or because I know those diagnoses too are pretty broad.
Yeah.
But again, we need to consider many other factors.
You know what's really funny? As we're having this conversation and as I'm thinking, I'm putting myself in your shoes when you're working with people, and also in people's shoes when they come in to see you. Like, I'm trying to think about this from a lot of different angles. And what's coming to me is that's why I do this kind of interviews, because I know that when people come to see me, they have all of the symptoms that they might have, the diagnosable things and not diagnosable things, or relational patterns and all the things that people have. You could trace it back to all this other stuff too. That is why I have people like yourself on my podcast, right? Because when we watch the food and we watch the habits and we watch all the other things, all the other wellness aspects of our lives, interesting, our mental health gets better, right? So this is exactly the reason why I have conversations like this.
So a lot of the times, for example, I will see in women a lot of anxiety around food. Food, especially when it comes to weight and hormones and their own changes. And they don't know what diet to do next, or wonder if this food is making them fat. Oh, but then they've tried intermittent fasting, but that doesn't seem to work. And then they tried portioning their plate out, but they have this distinct memory from when they were a kid growing up, whether it was something their mother said or their father said, and somehow it just stuck. And now it's affecting them 30, 40 plus years later. So a lot of the times the questioning will go back to, like, for example, what were you told about food when you were growing up? Because even that's changed a lot over the decades. So
not even the food, just bodies, how we're supposed to look like your habits around food, how do you eat the food? Also, not from my therapist's head, relationship around food, how meals played out between with family members. Maybe that's when all the blow-ups happen during dinner time, or mm-hmm. just whatever, all the things that show up in families, right? So much tied up in that. Very good. Yeah,
exactly. And then a lot of the time, so when I'll recommend, so I always do a 6-day diet diary with people. And mm-hmm. so as much as it is for me to see, okay, not just what are they eating, but what time are they eating? So I can yes. really see the space, how much water are they drinking, bowel movements, sleep, and all of that. A lot of the times it helps so-called wake them up and say, oh, maybe this is too long in between meals, or really, I haven't been drinking enough water. You know, it's a bit of an, oh, wow, I really need to get on this.
Yeah.
And so, but it's in those times that, okay, now they're making change, that sometimes those old scripts come up. And at the same time, you know, this is also what they were used to. And, you know, it's all part of our nervous system that they haven't really thought about rewiring yet. So when they're coming saying, okay, what can I do for hormones? I need to lose the weight. And then it's this black, white, either or. It's like, whoo, that's a lot of energy. So let's rein it in, step back. So then again, it kind of begs the question, because these are also generally, for the most part, generally healthy people, mm-hmm. of how long has this been going on? Let's see what else we can clear up. And that's, you know, as we so-called say, peel the layers off the onion mm-hmm. when it comes to really getting into the core of the issue.
Yeah, very good. So a lot of that had to do with food, with like the usual wellness things, right? Food, water, exercise, sleep, the timing of things, bowel movement, like all the basics. Mm-hmm. So how does mental health manifest in there? Like the brain or the neurotransmitters? Like what is the, what's the tie-in between the two there?
So what I'm also looking out for in their diet diary is, did they fill everything out? Did they return it? Did they remember? It's the same thing with supplements. You know, there's a certain number of pills in the bottle of servings, whether it's powders or liquids. Mm-hmm. So that's the other thing. Are they also compliant? Mm-hmm. So a lot of the times, or really all of the time, it's not that I slap the patient's wrist for not taking it or not doing the diet diary. But I'm actually more curious as to what that barrier is.
Yes.
And so is it a motivation issue? Is it that we need to change things up and maybe they couldn't express that properly, which again is going to go back to, you know, is there any fear around this? What were they told as a kid? Mm-hmm. So a lot of the time, there was a period of time that I was working a lot with boundaries with women. Okay. You know, with themselves, with food,
yes.
relationships, with life, you know, how to, you know, even create that ideal schedule. And sometimes that will come up. But when we think of the motivation piece, you know, that could also be if they're not getting the right nutrients, the right sleep, and having manageable stress levels, are they really able to make all the neurotransmitters that they need? Like the dopamine, the reward hormone to feel good, the serotonin. Our happy hormone, that long-lasting hormone.
Yes.
So these are kind of all the pieces. So again, if they're overstressed, overthinking, trying to throw spaghetti on the wall, hoping that it sticks, well, that stress is not only going to mess with their neurotransmitters, but again, it's going to mess with their hormones. And that's going to affect their brain as well. So then chances are they're coming and saying, oh yeah, well, I'm having some brain fog.
Right.
And it started, then you kind of see this whole picture start to complete. Mm-hmm. And we say, okay, great. What's the biggest support you need right now? Mm. And then that's where, yeah, we kind of go from there to say, okay, do we need more counseling and a little more hand holding? Or do we just really need to get those nutrients in?
So interesting that we could fix so many things with food in and of itself. Mm-hmm. You know, that's just like such a concept. I need to get a farmer in here or something. Right. So interesting, right? And also in the food, I mean, we might eat, but then, I mean, this is a complete tangent. we think we're eating healthy, but yet, you know, a lot of times the quality of the food and some things might not be indicated for your specific body type or just your own body. And it's like, so you think you're doing the right thing, and then yet you might be sabotaging in some way or messing yourself up in some way, right?
Right. Well, and the other piece to that is that it's not always we are what we eat, but we are what we absorb. So throw that into the mix. So then again, if they're stressed out, and how many, and I would have a lot of women come in, and I wouldn't, like, it wasn't SIBO or lactose intolerance necessarily, or any of those even more functional related diagnoses. They're just bloating, constipation. It's like, well, are they chewing their food? Mm. How long has this been going on? So a lot of the times we'd also need to work on the guts. Right. As well, to make sure they were, you know, even getting the nutrients in properly.
Oh, so much nuance here, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then somebody comes in and they're sharing all these different things that make them feel unwell. They think they want to work on their hormones. You might recognize, or they might share that they're taking psychotropics. They might have some mental health stuff going on. They could all be related to each other. Like, they're all building, you know, like the whole wheel there is turning, like everything's connected. And so they might be on medicine. So what's your take on psychotropics, and how does that play a role in this conversation? Like, how would you support somebody with that?
Of course. So I remember one of my colleagues, he said, wait until the patient says they'd like to get off or they'd like to start titrating down. Because interestingly, I mean, there are times, you know, I've sometimes brought it up saying, hey, this is a possibility. But again, let me know when you're comfortable. Make sure they have the right support. But what I will say I have noticed is that there's also different reactions. Because if they've been on, like for some people, if they've been on one for such a long time, they just may say to me, no, forget it. Work around it.
Right.
Okay. We have lots of other things we could do. Others I've seen have tried to wean themselves off of it, which usually does not go very well.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of the times we need to put stuff in place, optimize health, make sure they're doing all the lifestyle things, and then maybe we could start to touch the medications. And so from there, that's where, okay, we get the right things in place. Again, make sure especially their vitamin D levels are optimized.
Right.
And, you know, also too, maybe make sure it's the springtime, a little warmer, you know, just have the weather be optimal as well, you know, should they decide to start coming off of it.
That's interesting. That makes complete sense to time it to the seasons, because as we know, the winter is tougher on people
mm-hmm.
with mental health things. And that's an interesting observation too. Maybe we start in the spring, right? And just make sure that your vitamin D is up to par, and just, I'm sure there's other things as well to go along with that. So how do you optimize? So then coming off the medicine, your brain's not going to go, woohoo, like wackadoodle, right? It's like, it's going to have everything that it needs to function well without the medicine.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very good. That makes sense. So it sounds like your approach is to get people off at some point if they're open and willing, that would be your preferred thing. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. And I know there's also a lot out there, you know, around the psychiatry field. And I mean, it is pretty big. There's a lot of people who just don't believe in any psych meds at all. Mm-hmm. But I've also seen it make a difference in people. So right. It's almost like I don't want to discount, you know, just somewhere it really can help. On the other side of things, because we also have people across all spectrums of health, is it, you know, truly the right thing for everyone? It may not be, because as we see with mental health, as I was saying, it could be hormones. It could just be maybe they're going through a rough patch and just need some human support type deal. So it could be, I feel like it could be a whole different conversation. But a lot of the times, kind of like with birth control, for example, psych meds were only meant to be on for a short period of time. And I feel like that's what a lot of people miss. And then so all of a sudden, they're now on this psych med longer and longer. It's not like they had their neurotransmitters tested. So I used to say too, psych meds were part guessing game as well. So especially when you start combining them, and you know, because then you're talking about not just a hormone in the person's body, but then these, a lot of these psych meds are acting on the receptors. So you're working on both ends, sort of in this unknown. So again, some are meant to be for a short period of time, but more often than not, people are just kept on them for, oh, well, let's see what happens. And also a lot of these medications deplete the same nutrients that we need to make the proper hormones and neurotransmitters and balance blood sugar, which could also be a huge piece when it comes to mental health too. So, you know, again, working with all those different risk factors and having the knowledge of, yes, maybe some will be helpful, but it's not going to be a magic pill. And you really need to make sure that you have lifestyle and food, as we talked about, and play and all these other factors in place.
Wow. Yes. You know, that's one of my biggest gripes with psychotropic meds. And as a therapist, I say this cautiously, that's not my number one go-to. And I, of course, don't discourage people that people do what they feel that is right for them and what they need. But they go see primary physicians or GYNs, and they're prescribing them psychotropics. You know, like, and like you said, like, they haven't measured anything. Like, you're depressed here. Let me give you a prescription for this. Let me give you a prescription for the other thing. And even psychiatrists are not really measuring. What are they measuring? You know, like, they're just prescribing. And it's like, wow, do you even know what's going on in this body? And they have all these other things going on. And like, they might be counteracting with each other, depleting other parts of the body. That's not getting any support whatsoever. You're just making the problem worse in the body. That shows up in the head, and then everywhere else in life, right? As a result as well. Right. Yeah. So this is one of my pet peeves for sure. So I'm glad that we're on the same page here, I think.
Definitely.
Yeah. So very like true. Nothing against them if it's they're done properly and that's what's needed. Like if people are really struggling, of course, that's your life vest, right? So let's get your head above water. Let's support you. But let's make sure that we do that properly so you're not shooting yourself on the foot at the end of the day. So that you're making things worse at the end of the day, right?
Right, right. And the great thing is too, there's so much research and natural therapies out there, though I will caution, there is a lot of herb drug nutrient interaction when it does come to psych meds. But again, you know, food, getting the, you know, exercise, doing some, you know, doing things that you know, that people enjoy, I mean, that's also part of being human. It's part of functioning. It's, you know, we're in these bodies and have a lot of emotion, so it's so important to also have those outlets.
Absolutely. And those in the sleep, the sex, the play, the exercise, all of those things also impact all the biochemistry. So you're creating your own things that you need by engaging in certain activities, right? So then playing with that lifestyle, playing with the flow for the day or the habits or the things, like when you start making the tweaks, the good nutrition, the supplements, and some of these other lifestyle tweaks. Oh, now it's a whole wellness perspective. We're supporting all the different things. Now your body's functioning much better. You're actually getting more mileage out of your body, more like a better experience. Beautiful. That's what we're shooting for. Okay. So if you, I guess you kind of been answering that as we're going, that, that if people want to come off, it needs to be done intentionally. And so do you want to say more about that? Like, what would that look like if people are ready?
Yeah. So a lot of the times, you know, we'll talk about just what got them on in the first place. And I've heard reasons as simple as, I don't know, I was going through some stuff as a teenager and this was the only solution and no one questioned it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah. And I've also heard where, oh, maybe they've been through some really tough stuff and just still need a little bit of a buffer. Mm-hmm. So I've definitely heard the spectrum, you know, of why people have been on it and for how long. And then that's usually where I say, great, but we're still going to take a look at your cortisol levels and your hormones. Because, well, especially in this day and age, there's so many different ways that are, yes, we can be well, but I also find, you know what, let's make sure we can rule out hormone imbalance as well, just because estrogen kind of acts like serotonin, but even men and women tend to have high estrogen or what's called estrogen dominance. Mm-hmm. So again, even though it could act like our happy hormone, anytime it's out of balance, it's not going to be acting so happy.
Right.
Progesterone, which can act like GABA, which is our calming neurotransmitter, and progesterone being a calming hormone. Well, if we have high estrogen, a lot of the times we have low progesterone. Because if our body's constantly in a fight or flight, you know, in this sped up response, the last thing we're going to be taking a look at is digestion and reproduction. So the good news is those are one of the first things that I start to look at to balance things out. So this is where I really like to get a sense of what are our cortisol levels are doing. So cortisol, it helps wake us up in the morning, drops throughout the day. Then melatonin, our most potent endogenous antioxidant, rises at night. And then actually throughout the night is when we make most of our hormones, including insulin, thyroid, estrogen, progesterone. Mm-hmm. So this is why sleep is so important. And then, so if we get a sense of, hey, what are your stress levels doing? Where are your hormones? We know how to target wellness a little bit, because it can be a little tricky to, you know, do neurotransmitter testing, you know, if they're already on certain medications.
Right.
So that's where I say, okay, let's take a look at what else is going on. We could certainly help clear up the gut a little bit. Because again, I do see a lot of gut stuff as well. Mm-hmm. And then just start getting those nutrients in, where then a lot of the times I find they're clearer. They are listening to their body a little more. One of my favorite remedies too are different flower essences.
Ooh.
Because those are energy medicines, a homeopathic, there's hardly any substance in there. Mm-hmm. And it's not going to interact with the psych meds. But it's a great tool that literally they can have, whether in their back pocket or in their bag, but they can either drop on their tongue or put in their water bottle. And these different flower essences, especially the Bach remedies, they could have messages like feel secure and being more confident.
Affirmations.
Yeah.
That's so awesome.
Yeah, so these are the different ways that I'll say, hey, you know what? We could still certainly work together, you know, and then getting their labs optimized. So, you know, again, making sure their blood sugar is good, because that tends to be a pretty common issue, both with hormone imbalances and a lot of mental health.
Yes.
Yeah. So, and then their thyroid, because that's huge too. It's like, are they really tired and not feeling themselves? Or did no one test their thyroid in how many years?
Right.
which helps rule our metabolism. So this is where, we get a full thyroid panel, an iron panel, taking a look at cholesterol, making sure everything's lining up, and your typical red and white blood cells and electrolytes. And then, of course, vitamin D, B12, so we could put some nutrients on there. Mm-hmm. A lot of times I like to do homocysteine. It's also a good both metabolic marker, and I could see how they're metabolizing things as well. Mm-hmm. And so these are the different ways that it doesn't mean, okay, you come into my office and there goes the medication, or it doesn't have to be that either or approach, but we're adding tools in, we're adding knowledge in, we're adding, here's how your body is functioning right now, but here's the next steps to where it could be a little better.
Right. That is so beautiful. So they might be on medicine. They might be thinking, they might come to you because they're overweight, not feeling happy with their weight, or just have the belly pouch, or they can't lose their weight, or just feeling female things, hormonal things. Like they might have all the menopause symptoms, whatever things they might have going on, right? And then on the side, you know, like, oh yeah, then there's mental health symptoms going on as well. And it's like, well, not for nothing. Like if we rule it all down, all these organs are working together. So if one is off, well, a lot of these other things are going to be off. So it makes sense that the hormones are mimicking some of those neurotransmitters, that of course it's going to make sense that you're going to have brain symptoms or mental health conditions and symptoms. And it's going to show up in the gut too. And then physically in your sleep and your eating and your energy and your sex drive and your appetite, like in all the different things, right? So very interesting. Everything's interconnected. So it makes sense to look and test for all of those things and what's out of whack, what's deficient. address it, get it back online, get all the organs talking properly to each other and aligning and supporting each other. And then voila, all of a sudden, all of the symptoms start going away and all of the different organs. That's what I'm hearing. Is that right?
Correct. Yes. Yeah, so, you know, we're taking a multi-pronged approach, you know, a multi-system, looking at mind, body, and of course the spirit. Are they happy? Are they doing what they want? You know, do they have healthy relationships, which is so important? Because of a lot of the times I find, or what I'll see, is maybe if one partner wants to get healthy, the other partner may be kind of side-eyeing them, like, what are you doing? Or may find it intimidating. So right. It's not uncommon for that to happen as well. So this is also too where I usually counsel people as far as, yeah, just be mindful of who you hang out around, or maybe that, you know, that club or that outdoor activity with a group of people would actually be beneficial. So
right. Yeah,
there's, again, a couple of different approaches.
You know, I that's beautiful, adding that a spiritual component to that, in that there is all the things at play, not just this body or this organ, right? Or just my thoughts and my emotions. There's other things also that impact, again, everything. And so the relationships, the interests, the activities, how we use our time and what things we participate in and who with, how are they impacting things too? I love what you said earlier, like what we absorb, right? So it's not just environmental taxing and, you know, in the air or in the water or in the food, like, or things that we just might absorb in different ways that we don't even know that we're ingesting or taking in, but just energetically also, I'm hearing, you might be absorbing other things too, right? Just like when people have bad vibes, you know, like, you don't feel so good after you hang out with them. There's a reason for that. So, exactly. Well, there's a lot of different reasons, but, you know, for the sake of this conversation.
For the most part, yeah.
Yeah, so what else about spirituality? So you mentioned a few things in terms of the activities and how to resource oneself and just things that give us pleasure and that feel good. How else can the spirituality angle support the health and wellness journey, especially when it comes to mental health?
So I have found more meditative type activities. So meditation, yoga is a big one. I find that's such a great way of being aware of your breath and moving at the same time. And if you didn't know, there's different types of yoga. And I remember, you know, many years ago, so I was a competitive gymnast, so I was always on that go, go, go. It took me a lot of tries to really get into yoga. So if anyone can resonate, it's not just about, oh, just sit there and breathe and do a few movements. It's a thing. It's a bit of a workout for the mind.
And for the body, may I just add. Depends on which.
Yes, especially if it's the power vinyasa or even the more vinyasa type class.
103 degrees to add the heat to that one.
Mm-hmm. Yep, done that too.
Yes.
Right. And so I would say, yeah, the meditation, the vinyasa, those are, you know, just, or yoga in general, those are great places to start. And the nice thing is now they're definitely more mainstream. Getting outside, putting your feet in the dirt. So called grounding. So that's going to be so important to help change some of those electrons in our body. Just, you know, again, help us stay grounded, stay more zen. Just getting outside, being in the natural sunlight, being out in nature. Journaling, artwork, coloring. They now have adult coloring books.
Yes, I know.
Mm-hmm. And then, pretty. Yes. And the big question, which you may be familiar with too, is what did you like to do as a kid? Go back to that.
Yep. Very pretty. So these are things that could be added to the self-love practice, a self-care practice, right? So that could be woven into the daily routine, into creating healthier wellness, self-love connecting points during the day or habits. So if we take it to the next level here, would you add any metaphysical aspects to the spirituality angle? Like, what else would you throw in here? Like, what might impact mental health from that angle, if anything, to your knowledge?
So one of the things I really like is sound healing. We are vibrational beings at the end of the day. Different bowls have different tunes, or different healing properties, I should say. Yes, they have different tunes too. But they do, you know, hit different organs for the system as well. But I have found it just from some of just the research, the knowledge behind it, how they're made. And then usually during sound baths, the person has a chance to relax. So it's like, even if you can't always relax during the day, here's literally maybe a half hour or an hour you can carve out and just receive. So that's a big one too.
Oh, I love that. That's right. So there's a lot of different modalities in where we could address the spiritual body of our body, right? So we are addressing the physical, we're addressing the mental, we're addressing the emotional. Why not address the spiritual too? Like that gets lost in translation a lot of the time. And a lot of these practices support that. So I love that. And the sound bath, that's terrific to add to this conversation. Any other ideas for more alternative wellness spiritual practices that could be added to this conversation that would help with the gut, the hormones, the brain, you know, the sex organs, all of the organs?
So, you know, again, usually while I am very well versed in supplements, or and as far as like picking and choosing for the patient, so that's, you know, certainly my forte. And whether I'll choose a flower essence for them, or I'll say, you know what, see what resonates with you, you know, you can go on and, you know, pick a few. There are times, again, depending on the patient, especially if they tend to be a little more sensitive, you know, just sensitive to people's energy, maybe being out there and need a little help grounding, I'll recommend certain crystals to people as well. I know the tiger's eye bracelet has become very popular. I've actually seen that on quite a number of people nowadays. So for anyone out there, tiger's eye, really good for the solar plexus, which is the belly area. So it can help with some gut stuff, and then confidence. So that's really what it's for as well, helping with a bit of that shield and that protection.
Very nice. You know, since you brought up the chakras, can you, just for people who might not be very familiar with this concept, like what are the chakras? What's the concept of the chakras? What are they? And what organs might they be related to? So people know if like, oh, I have this pain right here. What chakra is that? You know, and how can we address it from that angle as well? Whatever group of symptoms they might have.
Of course. Great question. So yeah, so the chakras are, they're energy centers that travel along the spine. So we have the root chakra, which circles in red. So it's sort of like a rainbow of colors that go from the base of the spine upwards. However, in the Indian tradition, they also know that there's over 100 of them. Like we have many chakras throughout the body.
Yeah.
Through our hands, our feet, and all of that. But for these purposes, what we need to know is, so there's the root chakra that's at the very base of the spine. And this is our security. This is our grounding, the I am, like, you know, really just knowing who we are. So that vibrates in red. Then shortly up around our, around our reproductive organs, it radiates orange. So this is also water. So this is the emotional piece. So this is where dancing and movement and exercise can really come in. You know, especially, well, for men and women too, and helping reclaim their power, reclaim their health, and, you know, to help get back into their bodies. A little bit above, kind of around the belly button, a little bit above that. So that's where I was talking about the solar plexus, which is yellow, which is a lot about confidence. So if we think about it, and then what are we digesting? So if we're also not, we're kind of out in the world, like, oh my God, where do we go? Well, that's going to correlate to, well, what's our gut doing as well? Our gut may be acting up. So we do tend to see some correlations between both the spiritual and the physical.
So before you keep going up the ladder there, so with the root chakra, what would be some physical ailments that people might find? So like what conditions or what organs might be off, or what pains might people have that might indicate that the root chakra, the energy there might be a little out of whack, or that they might need some support there emotionally? What might be some of the emotional things that might happen around that one?
Yeah, so physically, so it's low back pain, sciatica. Mm-hmm. So tends to be more, yeah, literally like the lower issues, some of the nerves and everything, because a lot of those nerve roots come out from the base of the spine. Mm-hmm. Emotionally, they may just not feel great with where they are.
Right.
You know? So yeah, they may just feel a little unbalanced, which again is then going to come into the sacral chakra of, well, then how will they, oh my God, how are they going to achieve balance? Well, do they need to control everything? So then this is where we may see, okay, this, as I was saying earlier, that black, white, either or, oh my God, then they have all hands on deck. And here, look at all these supplements I'm taking.
And I
say, great. You know, and actually my response too is because I have had patients bring me many supplements and I say, great, let me take a look at the dose. We'll max out what you have. Maybe put some on the back burner and create a plan. How does that sound? Mm-hmm. And then they could breathe again.
So, that's awesome.
And then that comes into the solar plexus of that, oh, who we are, that confidence,
mm-hmm.
you know, and how we feel about ourselves.
So let's go back to the second one for a second. Yeah. So with the sacral chakra, So the first one is the root one. It's called the number one chakra, maybe.
The root chakra
is red and it shows up with lower body pains, and it shows up emotionally as maybe feeling insecure, safe, distrusting.
Or like pelvic floor issues.
That's good, right? Pelvic floor issues, very nice. And emotionally, like I said, all those things. For the sacral one, it might show up controlling and over-functioning and like that kind of stuff I'm hearing. And what kind of physical ailments might they have when that one is a little off?
Hormonal imbalances. So this could be weight, estrogen dominance. So or like men losing their hair, because that's also part of like their testosterone maybe going into a more potent form of testosterone. With women, because again, like hormonal imbalances, they may have the mood changes and the weight gain and the missed periods or the too long periods or the prolonged ones. So a lot with the menstrual cycle. And then libido is going to be in there as well.
Right. Very good. I think that also creativity is part of this chakra, right? So maybe people feeling stuck or unmotivated. Is that right? I'm not sure if I'm combining some of them.
Well, and what's interesting is that they all sort of work and can weave together own way. But it's true. I mean, one of the great ways to express, you know, the sacral chakra to help heal it is to move your hips, get going, get dancing.
Right. So that's kind of a solution to help with the sacral chakra. Mm-hmm. Any solutions for the root one?
Well, so the root one is getting out in nature. Getting your basics in.
Oh, I love it. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very cool. So I'm seeing a table now, right? So you you have the chakra, you have the emotional, you have the physical, you have the solution. Okay, very nice.
Mm-hmm.
So we have covered all those bases for the root one, we cover all those bases for the sacral one. So keep going with the solar plexus. So the gut, confidence.
Mm-hmm. And to an extent, the adrenals as well. Mm. So the adrenals, which are the two little glands that sit on top of the kidneys, which are so important for our sex hormones, salt water balance, and cortisol, as well as our adrenaline. So, yeah. So, and it's interesting because the adrenals can be, some say sacral, some say solar plexus. So
I was wondering. Interesting. Border. Yeah. Cool. So those are the body parts that get affected by that chakra. What about emotionally? Well, how that might show up?
Emotionally, maybe you're a little too timid and it's one of those, I feel like usually the person knows when they're maybe not stepping into their full power. And this could just be, you know, the person that wants to just stay in the back of an exercise class, for example. And hey, you know, maybe if they just really want to and that's their thing, like, great, have at it. But where I'm sharing is more from the intention side, or, oh, can they really do this? Can they, or maybe there's a mountain they want to climb. Oh, do they have the strength to do that, for example?
Like they're holding themselves back with doubt kind of thing. Very good. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Lovely. So let's keep going up that spinal column. What's the next one?
Of course. So the next one is the heart chakra. Mm-hmm. So this one is what's said to help connect the more spiritual, what's, you know, the chakras above the heart to the one, to the more physical, which tends to be below the heart. So the heart's sort of that midpoint. And so the heart chakra, yes, it's about love, but it's also about love for oneself. It's relationships. It's literally, you know, at being from the heart.
Yeah.
And so that one is colored green.
Yeah. And so with when there is an issue with that one, what kind of body symptoms or health issues might somebody have?
Oh, people could be closed off, heart disease issues, anything really under that spectrum. But this is, you know, it's funny, the first thing I thought of too was body language. You know, if people start crossing their arms, leaning back, it's like they're literally trying to shield themselves from something.
Right. So protected, these are guarded.
Exactly.
Cool. So those are the physical symptoms. And what would be some solutions or suggestions for people who might find that that this one might be the one that's getting them a little bit?
Yeah. Well, interestingly, the heart chakra can also be represented by the color pink. So people can wear green shirts or even pink shirts. That, you know, to help, like as a color therapy, to help heal the heart chakra.
So pretty.
Yeah. And animals are fantastic for this because animals, you know, they're unconditional love. So just, yeah, being able to hug them, you know, have them slobber all over you, you know, unless you get a really friendly cat to do that.
That's so interesting. Can I just share a quick little tangent side note here? I have an elderly dog. And I keep, this has been the theme of my life recently. So if anybody who's heard me talk about my dog, I apologize if I'm boring you to death. So he's 15 and a half and he's giving me a lot of work. So keep me up at night, during the day, there are accidents. So it's just physically intensive work and then emotional and lack of sleep, all the things. So he's like really having an impact on me. And this morning I had the awareness of, I was cleaning him and whatever. And then I had this, he's rubbing against my leg, like leaning his head against my leg, and I'm going to start crying. And I felt from him the love. And I was like, you know, the more that I take care of this dog, the more that I love him, you know? It's like, so that came to me, that's interesting, that's coming up now. So totally, when you're part of animals, you know, that, like, I don't consider myself an animal person, but just taking care of him, it just feels like it's opening up my heart more and more, how much devotion I have for this animal, making sure that he's okay, you know, as much of it all he's taken on me. And it's like, it's an interesting stretch for me, a growth place for me, right? That you could give this much and feel depleted in some ways because of how much is being given, but by the same token, I'm so replenished and nourished by the connection, that it feels like the connection is growing more and more by the minute. It's such an interesting experience. I'm sure that animal lovers and people who have had a lot of pets could relate to this. But just, yeah. So we could use our animals for this particular piece of the work, right? If our heart needs opening, get yourself a pet. they will help you with that.
There you go. Yep, exactly.
So good. Yeah. So thank you for that reminder.
Of course.
So good.
Well, yes.
Beautiful. And so if we keep moving up that channel and that's spinal cord, what's the next chakra?
Next one is the throat chakra. So that's represented by the color blue. And interestingly, yes, it's about speaking, but it's also about listening as well.
Right. We forget about that part of it.
Yeah. What's the joke? We have two ears and one mouth.
Oh, that's so interesting. I love that. You know, It's interesting when I hear people say, I'm a great communicator, and there is no pause for somebody else to get one sentence in there. That is not being a great communicator. You're just an over talker, right? Or whatever the word is for that. Give and take, right? That's the good communication part there.
So a lot of the times this may show up as thyroid related issues. And actually the sacral chakra and the thyroid and the throat chakra too are pretty interconnected, because we need that creativity, then we could speak more, we feel more free, along those lines. So beautiful. Yeah, so a lot of thyroid concerns may show up with the throat chakra.
Right, very good. You know, I've had people who always seem to have a sore throat, or like just like infections that appear, like breathing things, or just congestions and coughing, like just like those kind of viruses that kind of seem to affect having a voice, right? Laryngitis, right? Does that fit? Does that make sense? I would belong here?
I'd say in a way, one of the things I thought about potentially from the more physical side was I would also be looking at their stress levels. To see, actually what's going on with their immune system.
That's true, right.
Maybe some of those chakras too.
Which chakras in charge of the immune system?
So I would say, I first thought of the adrenal. So again, that kind of borders between solar and sacral.
Right. Okay. Interesting. Good. Yeah. Very good.
Yeah.
And so for the throat, then what might be some solutions or offerings that we might have to help deal with any blockages there or any manifestations there?
Of course. I say to say what you want to say, especially for women. Hmm. If it comes to, let's say someone offers you something, it's more than okay to say no, thank you. just saying. Speaking your truth, which could also just be, speaking from the heart, speaking honestly. Not always pushing things down, so to speak. And of course, listening, being able to listen and really be engaged in, what other people are saying as well.
Beautiful. Okay, good. That makes sense. Very nice. Okay, and then we're almost there. Now we're going to the sixth one, which is?
Yes. Oh, is that the third eye?
Right.
Yeah. And so this is too where I, I'm aware that, anxiety, depression, a lot of the getting caught in our head can really be a blockage to some of these. So this is sort of where, where we are looking with our intuition, or when people say the third eye, it's not just the physical of what we see, but it's what are we sensing? What's the energy in the room type deal?
Right.
Yeah.
So if there are any imbalances in the energies here, what might be some symptoms?
It could honestly be as simple as people getting caught in their head. Like even on the day-to-day, what do I do next?
Right.
It doesn't always have to be a specific diagnosis, but this could always be the, I got all these supplements for this, and then if I need to take this for the, it's the overthinking, the overanalyzing, fill in the blank.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Very nice. And so that might have the feel of micromanaging the partner, of helicopter parenting, OCD, depression, anxiety, just being in all convoluted and confused and tripping yourself up, kind of like overdoing it. Love it. Yes. Very nice. So what might be some things to counter that?
Yoga, sound healing, really anywhere that you can share that or not, your body doesn't always have to be moving. The mind doesn't always have to be moving, which I will say on the flip side is nice with yoga. You'll still get the body moving potentially as a distraction, but you can also come back within.
Right.
So where vinyasa is one breath to one pose, it actually can serve a bit of a distraction. But let's say if you're doing sound healing or a hatha yoga or some of the slower ones or a yin, then it may actually be a little more challenging, interestingly, because you do need to stay in a posture for a little longer. But these are ways that, yeah, we could certainly train the mind.
Right. So even though you're using your body for the poses and you're focusing on the breathing, and breathing is also physical, but because you have to focus, you're quieting the mind. And that's part of like that release there. Love it. Very, very nice. You know, I'm thinking some other physical, what might appear to be physical, but that would benefit all of these things that are alternative modalities, like acupuncture, or, you know, recently I came across, what's it called? Sensory deprivation tank, that way you just float.
Oh, right. Yeah, those floating tanks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's on my list of things to try.
Oh, okay, yeah, those are great. Reiki
right.
is also great. So Reiki, what is it? I believe they don't touch you in Reiki.
Right.
But it's just more of a sense of, yeah, they're just helping move the energy. They're holding space for you to just be there.
Yeah. So any modalities that kind of help the body release, the nervous system kind of let go and just kind of soothe, right? So breathing techniques, all kinds of different meditation techniques, the grounding, like you said, putting your feet outside on the grass and like that kind of stuff. I'm thinking also havening. I don't know if you're familiar. Where you just go like this.
Oh, right.
Not rubbing up and down your arms, but rather put, for those of you who are not watching the video, who are just listening, putting your arms, rubbing your arms down or caressing down, rubbing down, not up and down, your body, your chest, your legs, your face, and you're caressing down. The nervous system registers that as a soothing thing for some reason. I don't know the biology behind that. But so that's supposed to be really good for activating the parasympathetic nervous system and releasing or relaxing the nervous system. So just like a soothing technique, and you activate all the healing properties of the parasympathetic and the relaxation parts. So that's something else. So anything to support the body and like, right, letting go a little bit and just kind of like moving the energy. I love it. Very good.
I think so much of what we talked about, I just thought of too, going to a comedy club.
Hello, the fun things.
Totally gets you out of your head and you get to be entertained.
Totally. I mean, if we can get more into the practical, of course, dancing, sports, right, regular exercising, whatever people like to do, for sure, right? Playing around with the kids, cuddling up and wrestling, playing with the animals, like all those things too. Wrestling your partner, right?
Right.
Lovely. Okay, so let's go through for the last chakra, and we're almost out of time here. So let's kind of start wrapping this up.
Okay. So the last chakra is the crown chakra. So where the third eye is purple in color, the crown tends to be, I want to say, a light, very light purple to a clear. And this is our source of inspiration. So again, this is where should we be able to keep sitting with ourselves? You know, again, we could move our body a little bit. And sometimes our best ideas come from when we are moving our body. Right. That's part of where it filters through is the crown chakra, which is right on the top of the head.
Lovely. So if people are having a challenge with the energy up there, how might that manifest in any physical conditions or illnesses?
Yeah, so I would say it'd be pretty similar to the third eye where, you know, they're just not really able to get the ideas. They're just sort of in this, okay, let me just sit and wait for the idea to pop in. It's, you know, when people talk about being blocked, maybe brain fogged, just not feeling like themselves.
Headaches?
Yes. Oh, headaches, migraines. Yeah.
Sleep?
Those could be pretty...
Sleep issues, would that be associated with that or not?
It can be. I would say it depends. I would say sleep is more of the lower chakras.
Oh, interesting.
Just because, you know, you're falling asleep. You want to feel safe.
Oh, okay. Right.
You know, it's a thought. It's true, because then on the flip side, if someone can't fall asleep because their mind is just constantly going.
Right, that's what I was thinking.
Exactly. Yeah, that it could certainly be, you know, one of the higher chakras.
Yeah, very interesting. Lovely. Good. And then as a solution, support for that?
Solutions will kind of be similar too to the third eye and some of the others, is just to be able to sit with yourself. I would say, and again, I would say Reiki is a great one. Sound healing is fantastic. Anywhere, any practice that you can just know that you can be in your body, but also have divine inspiration and kind of and balance those two. So again, you know, these could be some of those more physical practices, or with things like sound healing, chanting, you know, which is also good for the throat chakra, but in those more high vibrational environments as well.
You know? Oh, very nice. Right. So I'm thinking stillness too. It's interesting because it's counter the movement, right? But maybe stillness of the mind, not necessarily so much the body, or both. It depends on what might serve. But when we get quiet, if we stop with the social media and the scrolling and the swiping and the binging Netflix and all of the noise, you know, like if you could just kind of chill out for a second, go look at the stars, go sit in the sun, go look at the birds, like just kind of like be in nature and just kind of like be, like that inspiration might come. Like you could actually listen, hear something else, or sense something else. So you're open for that inspiration, for the ideas, as opposed to just all this stuff comes in and you can't even hear yourself think, right? You don't even know what you're thinking.
Exactly. Yep. Definitely.
Very, very nice. Very cool. So in all, see if we could tie it all together, right? Because that was a lengthy conversation around the chakras. So how will we tie that awareness and information base about the chakras to the physical well-being and the mental well-being? Mm-hmm. How can we kind of put a bow on that piece, tie it together?
Yeah, so I believe there's ways that the chakras represent so much of that mental, emotional, and also physical and spiritual. And as we talked a lot about mental health, it's not just about neurotransmitters. It's not just about behavior, but it's these different aspects that are intertwined, that the chakras are such a nice example too of different aspects that people can also research a little further, whether they want to take it into crystals or clothes or other foods or, you know, different practices, because there's foods you can eat for the chakras. You can really go at it. And so, you know, there's so many different ways in thinking when it comes to wellness, that again, when we go down the certain risk factors, it's not, you know, it's not just, oh, okay, a couple of them and here's a prescription. It's okay. Where's the person at? Where's their belief system? Can they expand their mind? Do they even want to?
Right.
And then where do we go from there?
Right. Very good. So if these ideas are new to somebody, because if people are not familiar with the ideas of chakras or energy bundles or just this side of things, and they might be stuck a little bit in the pills, all the pills, right? And just overdoing all of the pills, or just overdoing it one particular angle, how can we introduce them to... there's so much more than meets the eyes, and that impacts everything. And it might be hard to stretch into that at first, but how can we embrace other things too, just to have our own back in different ways?
Yeah. I would say start where you're comfortable. If where you're comfortable is mostly supplements and maybe some flower essences, because sometimes that's more energy medicine, that could even be a little esoteric.
Right.
Then fine, we start there. If it's mostly food you want to start with, fantastic. As I said, I go through a lot of diet diaries.
Right.
If you do want to start moving into chakras, then I would actually recommend going to a library or a Barnes & Noble, where at least you have a set amount of books and you're not scouring thousands of pages off Google. Well, then getting fatigued. While then getting, you know, fatigued from the technology at the same time. So at least a book you can sit down with.
Excellent.
Yeah, I mean, I'm blanking on some authors, but again, books will give you a finite, amount to look at, again, versus how many Google pages.
Right, contain the amount of like you get the dose that you need to explore something. Mm-hmm. Oh, I love that. Very good. So as a journey, we have all the physical, like we were saying, the physical, the mental, the emotional, the spiritual. We're just covering all of the bases here. Any last minute thoughts as to how to be open to integrating or addressing all four bodies? Mm-hmm. And there's all the bodies, but like we'll focus on these for this conversation. People are like, what? What is going on right now? I thought I had one body. what's it like a thought, like a parting thought for just kind of being open to working all the angles and supporting ourselves the best that we can and nourishing ourselves the best that we can?
Well, I like how you said it, is that being open. Maybe if chakras don't resonate for you, but sound healing got some wheels turning. Mm-hmm. Well, then don't worry about going to the bookstore for chakras and all of that quite yet. And maybe just find a sound healing class. Maybe Reiki sounded really interesting. Right. Fantastic. Go try it. Maybe you just really want to stick with pills and that's your MO. Great. There's so many different ways we can go. Because even though we're addressing the physical body, we're still going to be addressing the mental, emotional, and ultimately, yes, that divine wisdom and how we think about ourselves and all that good stuff.
Beautiful. Very, very nice. So I will add there that to be on a health and wellness journey like this and to try to take care of ourselves in all of the good ways, in all of the different ways, takes courage. Mm-hmm. And I commend people for wanted to take care of themselves and being open to doing it in different ways, not to just do it one particular way and getting stuck there. It's not really serving them, but they don't want to try different ways. They keep doing the same thing over and over and it's not really working. It takes courage to explore different things. And so kudos to those people. Mm-hmm. And to have compassion, right? I think that you had that as a thought that you wanted to offer. So like anything with that you want to use as parting words?
Yeah, I believe that's a great point, is having compassion for yourself. The healing journey is not linear by any means.
Right.
It can sometimes feel like a doozy, but it can sometimes be very rewarding. And that's what it is. It's a journey. It's being able to constantly know ourselves and, you know, try all these different modalities, which isn't it fantastic? On the flip side, we do have so many modalities and so many different ways of healing that are now out there.
Totally. So no judgment for ourselves if we're bumping around a little bit, right? Just with love, compassion, and grace and ease. This is our second conversation recorded. We've had others, but so grateful for you and your resourcefulness and how much wisdom and just yumminess you bring. And anybody who's lucky to work with you, who chooses to work with you, I know that they will get a lot for all of the bodies and for all of the ways and all of the things. So thank you so much for being you and for sharing yourself with me and the audience. And I really appreciate you.
And thank you so much for having me.
Of course, of course. And to the audience, until the next one. Bye.